For those of you who don't know me, my name is David Van Zandt. I'm the president here at the New School, and I just want to welcome everyone to tonight's talk. I'll try very hard not to lean on your computer and mess up your, tonight's talk is going to be explore the trajectory of the relationship between India and China, the two Asian giants, which I think in many respects are close to each other. They're certainly geographically close, but also still in many ways far apart. So I'm very proud of the work that our India-China Institute is doing to try to pull those together. I mean, we're not a large organization, but I think all those steps helps to make a difference in what has to be in the future of the world a very important relationship. I'm also grateful to our key supporters who have made all of this possible. Let me get. It's going to be both. I think we have the. It's the Luce Foundation, right? It's the Ford Foundation. I'll get these and the Star Foundation. And I thank you very much for supporting this work here at the Institute. Now it's my great honor to introduce Ambassador Nirupama Rao, who has had a long and extremely successful career in diplomacy and foreign affairs. Among her many achievements was to be the India's ambassador to both the US and China at different times, of course. She was Foreign Secretary of India from 2009 to 2011. She's currently with us for the past month here at the Institute as a visiting fellow advising us on India-China affairs, also working on her book at the same time. At the age of 21, this is amazing, she sat for the civil service exam and was adjudged the most meritorious, topping the list of successful candidates. And then she went on to a very successful career in the Foreign Service. I mentioned a couple of those positions. She's also served in the Ministry of External Affairs in New Delhi, as well as other Indian embassies in world capitals around the world. I think during that period of time, you became focused and became an expert on India-China relations, which I think resulted in your serving in the East Asia Division of the Ministry of External Affairs from 1984 to 1992. You are a member of the delegation that accompanied the former Prime Minister of India on the historic visit to China in 1988, and you also have several firsts. The first woman a spokesman of the Indian Foreign Office, the first Indian woman to be High Commissioner to Sri Lanka, and currently you're working, as I mentioned, on a book about India-China relations. It's a great pleasure to have you with us for the past month, and I think everybody's looking forward to your comments tonight. So please, please welcome the ambassador.
Thank you, President Van Zandt, for those kind words. Dear friends, it's a pleasure to be with you today. Happy Cinco de Mayo. And in this very historic room, I feel Gandhiji is sort of overseeing what I'm doing today. And there's Sarojini Naidu besides him, behind him. So I couldn't be in more august company. So my talk today is a kind of show and tell. It's about India and China. Two countries, many relationships, and I've sought to illustrate it with interesting pictures from my point of view. So here you have slide one, and I would like to begin my lecture today with two mentions, and these are two quotations actually. One is from a poem by the American poet Maria Manes, and she says, "Borders are scratched across the hearts of men by strangers with a calm, judicial pen. And when the borders bleed, we watch with dread the lines of ink along the map turn red." And the second quotation is from the French philosopher priest Michel de Certeau. "What the map cuts up, the story cuts across." And I'm going to tell you that story today. And I feel these thoughts apply to the history of boundary disputes in the Indian subcontinent, as they speak of linear divisions created to fracture ancient narratives of cross-border interaction, of tribal geographies, of popular histories, and shared mythologies, or myths of origin, you may say. In the case of India and China, the civilizational relationship, the Himalayan consensus that could have evolved between these two giant neighbors, has been fractured by modern cartography and the ideas of nationhood and homeland sanctified by maps. In 1921, Kenneth Saunders, in his Haskell lectures, sought to create his vision of the traffic of ideas generated by Chinese pilgrims traveling to India across the deserts of Central Asia to obtain the teachings of the Buddha. His words read, I quote, "Take the master's tattered robes, let the winds of the Gobi whistle through your sleeve and cut you to the bone, mount his rusty red nag and set your face to the west. Then after this bitter journey at last, the great ice mountains loom in front of you and you crawl like an ant and cling like a fly to the roof of the world until on the topmost summit, still far away from the promised land, you realize two things: the littleness of human life and the greatness of one indomitable soul." Saunders was imagining the Chinese pilgrim Xuanzang traversing the long route from Xi'an to Buddhist India, a journey that literally made history. The story of Xuanzang is certainly one that fascinates the Chinese, even though they dwell very little on their country's relationship with India. The story catches their imagination for the courage, steadfastness, thirst for knowledge and wisdom, and the exploratory zeal of its hero, together with the overlay of legend over history. Early this year, what was advertised as an India-China film production on the life and journey of Xuanzang was released. That's the picture you see here. The role of Xuanzang is played by the leading Chinese film and television star, Huang Xiaoming, and the cast includes Indian stars. In fact, the symbiosis between the two cultures was regarded as organic enough for Peking University professor Hu Shi to remark at Harvard University's tercentenary celebrations in 1937 that the Indianization of China, the Indianization, was an outstanding instance of cultural borrowing, comparing it to the Christianization of Europe. And I'm indebted to Tarun Khanna for this reference. The story of the contemporary relationship between India and China begins in the early decades of the 20th century with Rabindranath Tagore and his deep attraction for China. Tagore's ideal of an Advaita of humanity, of the universal human spirit, resonated with the Chinese concept of Shi Jie Tatung, or the world in grand harmony. Tagore said that he, as an Indian, felt a spirit of great kinship with China, Shraddha, as he called it. Of course, Tagore had his critics in China, particularly the children of the May 4th movement, who felt that their country should not be lost in a paradise of poetry, and that it needed the machine gun to drive out the machine gun wielding imperialist aggressors. Oriental culture was no solution to this. Tagore never gave up his warmth of affection for China, however, and his establishing of the China Bhavan in Shantiniketan, the university he founded, was testimony to this. China Bhavan incubated several of India's earliest sinologists, including Prabodh Chandra Bagchi. In later years, during the height of India's freedom struggle, Mahatma Gandhi said he longed for the real friendship between China and India, based not on economics and politics, but on irresistible attraction. Then, he added, will follow the real brotherhood of man. This is a particularly interesting photograph. It shows Tagore in Beijing in May 1924. And behind him, on his left, the gentleman with hands folded behind him, is the famous Indian painter Nandalal Bose, who accompanied him to China. And behind, in the last row on the left, is Hu Chemo, one of China's most famous 20th century poets who died very young. And his interpreter was the young lady on his left, to our left, on Tagore's right. And in fact, I'm trying to recall her name, I think it was, she married Liang Secheng, the famous architect. And she was herself China's first female architect, the first woman. Lin Huilin. Yes, and it's a very interesting story. In fact, CCTV made a documentary of the life of this couple, Liang and his wife, and their friendship with the Fairbanks. They were great friends of John and Wilma Fairbanks. Tagore's desire to foster scholarship on China in India led to his invitation to the scholar Than Yun Shan to come to Shantiniketan, and he became a guiding light for China Bhavan. Than and his family made their home in India, becoming bridge builders in the relations between the two countries. To Than is attributed the saying that Sino-Indian relations are the most important of the most important. Than's son, Than Chung, is one of the foremost and most highly respected scholars of the India-China relationship today. He lives in Chicago, and a strong proponent of the need to recognize this relationship as geo-civilizational, that's his phrase, rather than defined by territorial boundaries and geopolitical space alone. The Chinese Indologist Ji Xianlin, who died in 2009, and whose recently translated memoir, The Cowshed, details his travails and treatment during the Cultural Revolution, has received considerable attention. But I remember Ji Xianlin for what he once wrote, that China's relationship with India was conceived in heaven and constructed on earth. And here he is seen at the left of this group picture taken at Peking University during the 50s. And I was privileged to meet him on at least two occasions when I was ambassador in Beijing, just in his twilight years. India's pioneering sinologist, Prabodh Chandra Bagchi, came from a tradition of scholars who envisioned the coordinates of India's relations with China as drawing sustenance from the long and ancient history of interaction between the two societies and peoples based on give and take, and inspired by the example of the intrepid pilgrims of yore. His quotation from Xuanzang, you can see it here, to friends in China to show that we are not forgetful. The road is long, so do not mind the smallness of the present. We wish you may accept it. Basically counsels patience, striving, and hope for the future of the relationship despite the smallness of the present. And I think this has a great deal of conviction and meaning. Even if modern day relations between India and China have many gulfs and distances to be bridged, there is enormous respect in China for India's cultural and religious contributions to Asian civilization, including China's. Luoyang in China's Henan province is an ancient city known for its ties with Buddhist India, as embodied in its famous White Horse Pagoda. In 2010, India completed the building of a Sanchi-style Indian Buddhist temple in the city that was inaugurated by the then Indian president on her state visit to China that year. It's another picture of the Luoyang temple. In 1939, Jawaharlal Nehru, later to be India's first prime minister, made a brief visit to Chongqing at the height of the Sino-Japanese War. The visit was to show solidarity with the suffering of the Chinese people. Nehru returned prematurely to India because of the outbreak of the Second World War, and he could not meet China's revolutionary leaders like Mao Zedong and Zhou Enlai. But there was great sympathy within India's freedom movement for the Chinese struggle, and the Congress Party of India dispatched a medical mission to Yan'an. One of its members was the young doctor, Dwarkanath Kotnis, who died a few years later while serving the Chinese revolutionary cause and is revered today in China as a martyr and friend. Kotnis is largely forgotten in India today, but his experiences in China bear testament to his extraordinary courage and integrity. And here you see this picture of the Chinese woman that Dr. Kotnis married, Ko Ching Lan, and their son, who was appropriately called Yin Hua, India, China. This young boy unfortunately died during the Cultural Revolution of some medical complication, I believe. Ko Ching Lan died in 2012. And every visitor, every leader from India, she would, you know, there would always be an occasion when they would meet with her. I think she was very well respected and known in that small circle that followed China. In 1947, India gained its independence, followed by China's liberation and the founding of the People's Republic in 1949. The Republic of India recognized the PRC soon after the latter's founding, and diplomatic relations were established in 1950. In the eventful period that followed, there were several personalities on the Indian side, besides Prime Minister Nehru, who played significant roles in the development and conduct of relations with China. Some of them are shown here. Ambassador K.M. Panikkar on the top left, the first Indian envoy to the PRC and the last Indian envoy to Nationalist China. Secretary General of the Ministry of External Affairs in the bottom left, Girija Shankar Bajpayee. He was Sir Girija Shankar Bajpayee. He was a member of the Covenanted Indian Civil Service. And he is believed to have held the view that India had every reason to be wary and cautious about China's entry into Tibet. And then on the upper right, you have Foreign Secretary K.P.S. Menon, a former Agent General of India in Chongqing and in Nanjing during the Kuomintang era. And then bottom right is Defense Minister Krishna Menon, the highly strung and deeply subjective political leader who enjoyed the trust and confidence of Prime Minister Nehru and was well known for his socialist leanings and his anti-American stance. Now we, you know, all of you who have studied India and China have probably heard this slogan, Hindi Chini Bhai Bhai, meaning Indians and Chinese are brothers. And the 50s were the era of Hindi Chini Bhai Bhai, or Indians and Chinese are brothers. The friendship of 1 billion, as it was portrayed, symbolized the era of Panchshil, or the five principles of peaceful coexistence. Contrary, of course, to public assumption, Nehru advocated a policy of cautious friendliness towards China, even telling an Indian delegation in 1952 to never forget that the basic challenge in Southeast Asia is between India and China. That challenge runs across the spine of Asia, unquote. He was also focused about safeguarding India's territorial integrity in the border areas with China, line or no line, as he termed it. On Tibet, he took the realistic view that there was not much that India could do to prevent the assertion of Chinese control over Tibet, recognizing Tibet as a part of China, although he was completely attuned to the mood of the Indian people about the sufferings in Tibet and the threat to the age-old culture and tradition of the Tibetan people. His decision to grant asylum to the Dalai Lama in 1959 was born out of this concern. This era enables the study of the contrast also between the personalities of Nehru and Zhou Enlai, each conditioned in very different crucibles of national history and experience, and the juxtaposition of the moral and often romantic idealism of Nehru with the diplomatic veneer of Zhou that masked an unemotional and calculated ability to maneuver and calibrate political positions. I have this extract from the New York Times from October 1954, which speaks of Nehru's visit to China that month, and how that 6 miles between the city and airport were walled by unbroken banks of humanity clapping, cheering, and crying the inescapable Chinese slogan, "Long live peace." I mean, that's unheard of in this day and time. Some more pictures from that era. This is Chou En Lai greeting Nehru in Beijing. Indira Gandhi is in the center of the picture. And visiting the Sun Yat-sen Memorial. And here you have Nehru and Chou En Lai at a New Year celebration in 1956 in India. It's quite an interesting photograph. And it was also a time when, you know, the Indians and Chinese, operated very closely and consulted with each other constantly. And, today it's absolutely unheard of for this level of closeness. You had Chairman Mao coming to the residence of the Indian ambassador to have dinner. And that's a picture of him signing the visitor's book with the ambassador R.K. Nehru. And R.K. Nehru was a cousin of Jawaharlal Nehru, but a ICS, Indian Civil Service officer, very distinguished, and his wife, Rajan Nehru, a couple that the Chinese were very fond of. So this is another historic picture. The Dalai Lama, here you have him in this picture, first met Nehru in Beijing in 1954 during the latter's visit to China. He recounted to me 2 years ago that when Chou En Lai introduced him to Nehru, the latter, Nehru that is, was speechless for a minute or so. I mean, Nehru just froze apparently, perhaps gathering his thoughts and emotions. And then of course Chou En Lai went on to introduce the Panchen Lama to Nehru, so the entourage moved on. In 1956, the date of this picture, in response to an invitation from the government of India, the Dalai and Panchen Lamas came to India on the occasion of the 2500th anniversary of Buddha's enlightenment. Chou En Lai was also present during this visit, and the tensions were apparent between all sides. I'm amazed at the size of those garlands. We don't see them in India today. The Dalai Lama and his entourage were keen on staying on in India, but they were persuaded to return to Tibet by both Nehru and Chou. It was during this visit that Nehru was apparently given to understand by Chou En Lai that China was essentially prepared to accept the reality of an eastern border following the alignment of the McMahon line. Subsequent events proved that China had not categorically given up their claim to the area. Now, 1958 was an eventful year in India-China relations. The Prime Minister and his daughter, after a long wait, traveled to Bhutan through the Chumbi Valley of Tibet by yak, by horse, by mule, on a trek across high mountain passes and rivers, a truly historic voyage for the then 69-year-old leader. Camping in Yatung, the site of the Indian Trade Agency, and a scene of eventful happenings during the Young Husband Expedition of 1904, Nehru met General Tan Quan San, the political commissar of the People's Liberation Army in Tibet, and also with ordinary Indian merchants engaged in border trade with Tibet, which was a huge activity at that time. Here you have them having dinner, Nehru and Tan Quan San and Indira Gandhi in Yatung. The trade agency in Yatung, together with the consulate general in Lhasa, were closed in 1962, never to be opened again. And the 1954 India-China agreement on trade between India and Tibet region of China, as it was then called, the famous Panchsheel agreement, lapsed. In fact, India also had a presence in Kashgar in Xinjiang province till about 1951, and the Chinese didn't want us to continue. And of course, there was a tussle between India and Pakistan as to who should occupy those premises. It's a beautiful little house. I've seen it myself. I visited Kashgar a few years ago. It was called Chini Bagh, or Chinese Garden. like the consulate in Lhasa was called Bekilinka, or the Garden of Joy, beautiful names. And Chini Bagh is now a Chinese restaurant. 1958 was also the year of the discovery by India of the fact that China had built what came to be called the Aksai Chin Highway, linking Xinjiang with Western Tibet through territory in the Ladakh region of Jammu and Kashmir, claimed by India. The discovery created a nationwide furore in India, and pressure began to mount on Nehru, together with criticism about his having soft-pedaled relations with China. Another historic photograph. When the Dalai Lama sought asylum in India in the spring of 1959, and this shows him actually crossing over into Arunachal Pradesh, the actual crossing point on that fateful day in March 1959, after a long trek from Lhasa. The relationship between India and China, of course, deteriorated further after this. And Chou Enlai was to disclose to Ambassador R.K. Nehru, I showed you his picture a little time ago, that the Tibet factor and India's perceived support for the Tibetan rebels, as also the insistence on the McMahon line, had contributed to a worsening of the climate of bilateral relations. It's another picture of the Dalai Lama. The conflict of 1962 that ensued came at the end of the period when the two countries attempted official talks in which their respective cases on the boundary question were put forward with no bridging of positions. And India took moves to enhance surveillance in areas along the disputed border with the aim of preventing what was seen as further Chinese ingress. These moves, enshrined in the literature of the boundary dispute as forward policy, provoked adverse reaction in China. And by September 1962, the two countries were engaged in military combat, which ended in the ceasefire of 21st November 1962. For India, the war was a humiliating and traumatic event, the memories of which are till this day embedded in the national psyche. Aa Setu Himachalam. These words in Sanskrit, meaning from Cape Comorin or Kanyakumari on the southern tip of the peninsular coast of India till the Himalayas, encapsulate the idea of India. The Himalayas particularly are seen as a God-given natural boundary, deified in Hindu religion as the abode of the gods, a symbiosis of culture, religion and geography, on which in colonial times, beginning with the British surveys, boundary lines separating India from its neighbors were drawn, often as moves in the great game. On independence in 1947, the new Indian government accepted all treaty obligations entered into by the British, as also the cartographic alignments of India's boundaries. And you can see there are disputed boundaries today. The dissection of borderlands and the resultant division of ethnic groups straddling these areas were accepted as givens in the consolidation of new nationhood. The requirement of seeking the formalization of these borders through negotiation and agreement with China especially was not a predominant concern, although the necessity of safeguarding India's concerns against China's ingress was fully realized. And I'd just like to point out, you can see this little hammerhead here, that is the territory that India regards as being occupied by China, the famous Aksai Chin region. You have a few passes in this sector, which is called the middle sector of the boundary, which are disputed between India and China, but there's not a whole lot of territory in dispute here. And then you have the Sikkim sector, which is basically undisputed. China has recognized the accession of Sikkim to India. And here you have the eastern sector, which is the Arunachal Pradesh boundary, and this is the McMahon line, which in India's view defines the international boundary in this area, but which is not accepted by China. China claims most of Arunachal Pradesh, as you know, and India claims all this territory occupied by China. And these are the disputed areas in Jammu and Kashmir, which makes it even, you know, as complicated as it can get. You have Aksai Chin under Chinese occupation. You have the disputed Siachen Glacier here. We hear of, you know, the tensions between India and Pakistan on this area. This is the area of Pakistan-occupied Kashmir, or Azad Kashmir, as it is called in Pakistan. And these are the northern areas, also under Pakistani occupation. They formed a part of the old principality of Jammu and Kashmir. And this area, you see this sort of with a dash line here, this is the area that was ceded by Pakistan to China under the Sino-Pakistan Boundary Agreement of 1963. So you see this kind of, you know, and this is, of course, Jammu and Kashmir under Indian administration. The whole of this region is claimed by India. And as you know, Pakistan also claims, you know, Kashmir. And you have the Chinese sitting here in Aksai Chin. The situation, in fact, let me go back to the last slide. The situation in the western sector of the border, this is the western sector, this whole region here, is complicated not just by what India sees as China's occupation of territory in the Aksai Chin area, but by Pakistan, as I said, having ceded Kashmiri territory under its occupation to China through the 1963 agreement, which, I must add, heralded the beginning of the much-vaunted China-Pakistan relationship that causes considerable dissonance and tension in the India-China interface. Now, while China terms the eastern sector of the boundary in Arunachal Pradesh as the sector of the largest dispute, Indian public memory is constantly reminded of the bitter battles fought in 1962. The tragic confrontation in Rezangla, a pass in Ladakh, is an example. This battle, often termed India's Thermopylae, is remembered for the valor of the soldiers who fought the surge of Chinese soldiers who came down the pass, and the Indian soldiers fought the Chinese to the last man. And as the memorial at the site in Ladakh reads, when Rezangla was later revisited, dead Jawans meaning soldiers, were found in the trenches still holding on to their weapons. You know, the bodies had been left there during winter time, and when the snows melted and they went back to reoccupy the pass, they found the bodies there. And this is the memorial which says, how can a man die better than facing fearful odds for the ashes of his fathers and the temples of his gods? This is the Indian Army Memorial at Rezangla, a very famous battle in army history. And this is the memorial at Tawang in Arunachal Pradesh, similarly enshrining the memory of over 2,420 officers and men who laid down their lives in this sector in 1962. Now, the town of Tawang, with its large Buddhist monastery, is a subject of considerable focus from the Chinese side, who say that Tibet held sway over it, stemming from the fact that it was the birthplace of the sixth Dalai Lama, and it paid Tibetan taxes. Now, Tawang lies well south of the McMahon line, and India regards it as being within sovereign Indian territory. Any question of conceding it to China in a boundary settlement is considered inconceivable in India. While the McMahon line was agreed upon between British India and Tibet in 1914, administrative jurisdiction in the upper areas of the line was extended quite slowly and in fits and starts during the last decades of British rule, not because the British were reconsidering their stand, that was not the case, but because of numerous preoccupations in sectors far away from the areas covered by the line. In Tawang particularly, India's administrative presence was extended in early 1951, a little over 3 years after independence. The Nehru government's decisiveness in this regard preempted any Chinese move to occupy the area after Tibet was brought under Chinese military control in 1951, because it could have been that the Chinese may have crossed the McMahon line to occupy Tawang if there had not been an Indian presence there. The eastern sector of the border, seen of fierce clashes in 1962, particularly in the Tawang sector, saw a military rout for India and the resultant exodus of civilian population from the area in a flood of panic and hopelessness. These displaced persons returned to their homes after the Chinese withdrawal, but the memories of those days have not faded. There has been no military clash between Indian and Chinese troops for some decades now. The last incident involving a military casualty was the death of an Indian soldier in a Chinese ambush in October 1975 at Tulungla in Arunachal Pradesh. So that's more than 40 years ago. However, in the summer of 1986, Indian agencies reported the presence of a Chinese encampment in the Sundarongchu area south of the McMahon line in the Tawang sector. Tensions rose as each side traded allegations and accusations of infringement of the line of actual control, both on the diplomatic and military fronts. The angry Chinese reaction to the announcement of statehood for Arunachal Pradesh in February 1987 compounded tensions further. It was against this background that Indian Prime Minister Rajiv Gandhi took the initiative to visit Beijing, virtually extending the olive branch. And no Indian Prime Minister had visited Beijing since October 1954, when his grandfather Nehru went there. It was an overture that was highly successful, diffusing tensions and setting the tone for the transaction of relations between the two countries until this day. The non-resolution of the boundary dispute has not prevented the growth of trade and economic relations. The situation along the line of actual control in the border areas has been managed through a series of agreements on the maintenance of peace and tranquility and confidence building. Present-day relations between India and China can be categorized as being in a state of competitive coexistence. While bilateral relations are defined as a strategic and cooperative partnership for peace and prosperity, the absence of conflict and the prevalence of tranquility in the border areas does not provide an adequate enough antidote to the negative fallout of the Sino-Pakistani alliance or the massive trade deficit for India in trade with China, superior comprehensive national strength of China, or the development gap between the two countries. So here you have the meeting of border personnel, senior military officers. In fact, this gentleman here is General Joshi, who used to be my military attaché when I was ambassador in Beijing. And he is now in Ladakh. And this is a border meeting taken perhaps a year or two ago, photograph of a border meeting. So the hoarding, the words of the hoarding at Nathula Pass, speaking of a road to a golden future, you can see that, this is what is said here. Once the Silk Route, now the road to a golden future. I think that those words may still appear quite utopian. Both President Xi Jinping and Prime Minister Narendra Modi have a reputation for strong leadership, driven by a proclaimed desire for their country's rejuvenation and ascent to real power in a distinctly nationalistic milieu within each country. Mr. Modi, who visited China a number of times when he was Chief Minister of Gujarat before he went there as Prime Minister of India, is distinctly enthusiastic about China's economic success and its lessons for India. He's invited Chinese investment and participation in the Make in India program for industrial and manufacturing development. Here you see him and Xi'an. It's quite a classic photograph. On the more strategic or geopolitical issues, however, he has not departed from the line of previous governments and has sought to further relations with both the United States and Japan, as if to signal Indian inclination to implicitly resist Chinese naval expansion in the Indo-Pacific and opposition to China's approach towards its maritime territorial disputes in the region. I chose this slide because Xiaomi, it's called Mi in India, is the most popular smartphone today. But you here you have, because you know, because of security concerns, and the defense establishment has apparently issued instructions to its personnel not to use Xiaomi phones. And on the other side, of course, the famous Indian festival of Diwali, it says Diwali with Mi, and Mi meaning Xiaomi. So Diwali is made in China. And yet another one from The Economist. It's about China's economic growth slowing down and India's, you know, accelerating, though it will take us some time to catch up. And what lessons can be learned from China, particularly because, you know, Make in India is the slogan of the times today in India. I think the first is the building of infrastructure, roads, rails, waterways, power, ports, airports, and telecom. China spent 8.5% of GDP on infrastructure during the period from the 90s onwards, compared to India's 4.7%. Secondly, as has been noted, China let selected industries and geographical regions take the lead in ramping up manufacturing. The sectors selected were export-oriented consumer goods, such as textiles, shoes, and toys, and infrastructure and real estate-related industries, such as steel, cement, glass, construction equipment, and shipbuilding. The East Coast took the lead, especially the coastal areas from Shanghai to Guangdong. These pioneering cases became examples for other areas to learn from and emulate. And those of you, you know, who would like to know this in more detail, I would request you to consult what Professor Anil Gupta and Haiyan Wang of the University of Maryland have been writing. Now, thirdly, China dismantled barriers to inbound FDI and also created several special economic zones which process rapid access to needed licenses and permits. And fourthly, the proportion of high school students graduating from vocational schools has steadily grown larger, so that 90 to 100% of the young workers joining China's factories are well trained. It is critical to close the gap in vocational skills if Make in India has to succeed. China's experience has proved this. I couldn't resist putting this slide in. It's called the Om Parvat. And the, you know, this, you see the snow on the summit. It's like the Sanskrit letter Om, you know, which we all, you know, recite, or, you know, when you meditate, you sort of repeat. Now, this is on the way to Mount Kailash in the Tibet Autonomous Region. So when I did the trek to Kailash a couple of decades ago, I remember seeing Om Parvat, and that's why it brought back very nice memories. But, you know, coming back to my talk, will India and China be able to evolve a Himalayan consensus to deal with the problems that have kept them apart? Borderlands were traditionally considered sacred, integrated spaces, not divided but united by history and geography, ethnicity, culture, and custom. And here you see this old Tibetan map, which is in the British Museum. You see how, you know, our people, or our people of the East, looked at cartography and looked at, you know, sacred places, mountains, rivers, pastures. You know, this is a very, I think, a very tell-it-all kind of map, so different from the grid references and coordinates and large scales and small scales that you talk about when you speak of modern cartography. As Easterners, maps were not about coordinates and grid references, but representations of sacred peaks, life-sustaining streams and rivers, grazing pastures, market centers, and places of pilgrimage. The Himalayas, stretching from the Hindu Kush and the Karakorams to the, you know, frontiers of Myanmar, hold the secrets of our future, whether in terms of climate, water, sustainability, preservation of tangible and intangible cultural heritage, transport and communication, disaster management and prevention, and human security. The traditional meaning of the Sanskrit term Shambhala means peace, tranquility, and happiness. How do India and China enable access to such a vision? The ISI mod in Kathmandu recently brought out a Himalayan water and climate atlas tracing the impact of climate change on water resources in five of Asia's major river basins, the Indus, the Brahmaputra, Ganga, Salween, and Mekong, all of which originate in the Himalayan region. It showed that the region's climate, which has been changing rapidly, will continue to do so in future, with severe consequences for populations locally and downstream. The principle of equality and mutual benefit stands out among the five principles of peaceful coexistence once jointly crafted by India and China. Beginning with that principle, India and China need to encode a new definition of peaceful coexistence with people and sustainable development issues at the center, particularly when it comes to borderlands. An encouraging beginning has been provided by the Kailash Sacred Landscape Conservation and Development Initiative of ISI MOD, which the new school is well aware of, and the India-China Institute particularly, involving trilateral transboundary collaboration between China, India, and Nepal on the conservation of ecosystems, habitats, and biodiversity in a sustainable development matrix involving the remote southwestern corner of the Tibet Autonomous Region, the far western districts of Nepal, and Uttarakhand state in India. The glimmer of hope thus generated should spur us on to look even more boldly beyond unsolved territorial disputes so as to facilitate the targeted relaxation of barriers to connectivity, border trade, pilgrimage, environmental protection, disaster prevention, and water resource conservation and management. That can be the beginning of a Himalayan consensus between the two nations. And I'd like to end with some advice which Prime Minister Nehru gave long ago for the future. Logic and cold reason are poor weapons to fight fear and distrust. Only faith and generosity can overcome them. And I'll end on a happy note. This is a Chinese magazine cover from the 1950s showing children, Chinese children, with an Indian elephant gifted by Prime Minister Nehru. Thank you.
Sufficient time to really have an exchange. So we have enough time.
Yes, I was. Ashok had warned me in advance.
We're making a conversation. It's very rare that we get this opportunity, and we are also very fortunate to have several scholars who work on India China here. So in a way, I think we just want to create a bit of a conversation with people who are present here. We have Ambassador, Reva Ganguly Das. Would you mind please come to the front? I think I would say you also should join in this conversation. And Deputy Ambassador Rachel is here. So I hope you too will participate because a lot is said. So really, on that note, I will take maybe a couple of questions. And please introduce yourself also.
I'm Mark Frazier, and I'm the Academic Director at the India-China Institute, and also a Professor of Politics at the New School for Social Research. I work on China primarily. First of all, just want to say what an amazing set of images and photographs. I've seen many talks on China-India relations, and just a really magnificent. I'm really looking forward to the book that comes out that I know will cover and help some of those wonderful images appear in the book. But my question really has to do with what you were really getting at the end of the talk, which is about the Himalayan consensus. And I guess it is hearing your discussion, especially about the 1950s period, can we say that a Himalayan consensus ever existed? was it almost, did it almost materialize in the 1950s? And except for the border conflict, you know, there would have been this consensus that you described. So what's the basis for it? Was it close to materializing, or did it materialize? And, you know, given the present moment, you mentioned Iki mode and water questions, is it possible, in other words, for the Himalayan consensus to emerge, even if the border is not yet or not ever, officially resolved?
Well, to answer the first part of your question, in the 50s, it was a period of national consolidation for both countries, and I don't believe issues of sustainability, of environment, of people-centered development were really focused on the way you would assume today. Of course, you had people Christoph Fuhrer, Heimendorf, and others, Verrier Elwin on the Indian side, who worked a great deal in our Northeast and worked on issues like this. I mean, you could translate that into a very 21st century idiom if you study the work of those people. But in terms of the dialogue between India and China on the issue of a Himalayan consensus, I don't think much focus was given to that domain of activity. I think borders were being defined and were being, in some ways appropriated, you would say, by physical or actual military presence. In the case of India, having accepted all the treaty obligations that came down from the British, I think there was perhaps some degree of searching in a way as to what the best course forward may be. It was very clear to everybody in the establishment in Delhi that frontier lines need to be held or preserved, and that those should not be given up. But when it came to the issue of Tibet, when it came to the question of Tibet, when the Chinese army entered Tibet, I don't think India at any point of time decided to struggle against that reality, let us put it that way. I think our Consul General in Lhasa at that time, Suman Sinha, famously said, "The Chinese have entered Tibet, the Himalayas have ceased to exist," literally. I mean, it was very different from the world we knew before that. So I think in a sense we came to terms with that reality. There was need to settle the issue of the Indian offices and agencies in Tibet. And from that stemmed the discussion that led to the 1954 agreement, and we gave up a lot of rights and privileges. But we did not discuss the question of the boundary. Perhaps a Himalayan consensus could have ensued from that. If we had placed the question before the Chinese, it's all right, we have settled, our discussions have reached a satisfactory conclusion as far as Tibet is concerned, and the question of an Indian presence there. But what about the boundary? What about the maps? I think that issue was skirted, and I think it cost us a great deal.
Yes, I'm Bill Einbruster, a retired journalist. Does India still have a consulate in Lhasa, and also in general, are you optimistic about the future of India-China relations, and if so, why, and if not, why not?
Right. No, India doesn't have a consulate general in Lhasa. The only foreign office or foreign presence, consular presence in Lhasa today is of the Nepalese. The Nepalese have a consulate general in Lhasa. We don't have any presence in Tibet. The buildings I showed you, the Deki Linka in Lhasa, I don't know what has happened to it. I presume it still exists, but it must have been built up by the Chinese, and maybe our Chinese friends will know. And Yathung in the Chumbi Valley, which is adjacent to Sikkim, I believe that building has been destroyed. That beautiful building you saw of the trade agency, a very historic building, doesn't exist anymore. But it's interesting that pilgrim routes today, I spoke of Mount Kailash. Earlier, up until this year, there was only one pilgrim route that the Chinese sanctioned for entry into Tibet, which was in the middle sector of the border, Uttarakhand, those of you who know the map of India. There was only one entry point at Lipu Lake Pass into Western Tibet. They have opened up a new access route through Nathula in Sikkim. So our pilgrims will actually be going through Yatung on their way to Kailash. So for the first time, we'll actually see what the Chumbi Valley looks like after so many years. It was such a big trading point. You saw that picture of the merchants. So we don't have a presence in Tibet. And the Chinese have not agreed to an Indian consulate. We're opening one in Chengdu. That's as far close as we've got to Tibet. And optimism about the future, I am by nature an optimist, and having dealt with this relationship for since 1984, which is 32 years, I think we've established a kind of equilibrium in the relationship. It seems to be on fairly steady and strong foundations. It's not easily shaken up. But if you're asking me whether, you know, there's friendship as a pot of gold at the end of the rainbow, I can't say that, yeah.
Institute, and China over the past decade has made a lot of advancement. The One Belt, One Road policy, the new Silk Road extending throughout Central Asia to Germany is really fantastic, and especially projects in Africa also. So that obviously challenges a lot of geopolitics and makes a lot of people upset, which was very clear 3 days ago. A few people read Washington Post op-ed by President Obama, saying that America should lead the way, not China, and TPP is the future, and China's stealing our jobs implicitly. Xi Jinping, at the APEC summit of November 2014, in a joint session with President Obama, said that the United States is most welcome to join the AIIB, and this One Belt, One Road policy, it's an open policy, not an inclusive policy. China has made repeated claims to India also, especially at the Raisina dialogue by ex-foreign minister. But there's still doubts in India with a lot of people I speak to. And in America, a certain unfounded paranoia, which also is, you see the militarization of the South China Sea, which is dangerous. So would you comment on that?
Well, I think there's been considerable debate on the issue of the new One Belt, One Road policy, please sit down, of China. And India has no exception to that. I think we've had a lot of protracted debate about what Chinese intentions could be. But as far as the AIIB is, the bank is concerned, the Investment Infrastructure Bank, we are part of that initiative, as you know. So we haven't excluded ourselves from that process. I think the some of the apprehension in India that has been expressed is about the China-Pakistan economic corridor. That is a kind of a bypass or exit route from the New Silk Road, and which traverses territory in Kashmir, which is claimed by India, but is under Pakistani occupation. So there's a kind of, obviously some resistance and opposition from the part of India. But India hasn't been frontal in its criticism of the New Silk Road Initiative. On the contrary, I think there are openings and perhaps opportunities that India, if we're pragmatic enough and realistic enough about where we stand at this moment, I think we could avail of. You think of the BCIM, the Bangladesh, China, in India, Myanmar initiative. We're thinking of connectivity. We're thinking of integration. We're thinking of new trade routes. We're thinking of regional economic cooperation. So I think it fits into that paradigm of thinking. And I don't see why we shouldn't, in any sense, not look more closely at what this initiative can offer for us. Take, for instance, Kashmir. And this is something I think we need to broach with Chinese scholars in the track two or track two and a half or whatever you call it. Take the state of Jammu and Kashmir. It had very, very close links with Chinese Xinjiang before independence. I showed you the picture of this consulate in Kashgar. I don't see why we should not have better connectivity between Srinagar, for instance, and Xinjiang. Why not? If not Kashgar, if the Chinese want to keep that closed, why not Urumqi, the capital? I think we need to create outlets. This is what I referred to when I talked of a Himalayan consensus. We need that kind of, you know, creation of space for people, because people are at the heart of any diplomacy that you conduct. It's not, it's true, business, trade, removal of barriers, new roads, but ultimately it's people you want to help. And I think in Kashmir, I think Kashmir has a very Central Asian orientation. That is its history, its orientation towards Central Asia, its orientation towards Tibet. Why don't we think of rekindling those connections?
Yes, please.
This is Prabhakar, an alumnus of the business school. This wonderful relationship, which started before Christ and developed into a peaceful coexistence, then deteriorated into competitive coexistence. The rupture occurred in 1962. Was there anybody, because Indian leader Nehru, his heart attack was, this was a precursor, he never recovered from the shock, we were told. Was there any warning about this deterioration of relationship? That is the first part of the question. Second part, this gentleman touched upon that. Is there any hope of these two giants coming, or any hope of a rapprochement between these two giants? Because leaders, If only they realize that, if they come together, this trade relationship, it can be the biggest trading block in this world. So is there any realization, can, third part of the question, can the Dalai Lama be instrumental in bringing them together? Maybe I should think it.
Well, His Holiness is a man of peace, and he's regarded like as such in India particularly, greatly respected, greatly revered. But, you know, it takes two to tango. We'll have to see how the Chinese react to that. I can't really comment on that aspect. But as far as the slide into conflict in 1962, I think from 1958 it was very evident. And more than, you know, doing postmortems about what happened, I think the most important thing is to understand what lessons can we learn from that. What are the lessons to be, why do we study history? To understand what lessons we can learn from that. How do we read the tea leaves properly? How do we understand what the warning signals are? How do we analyze what steps to take and not to take? I think there are many, many lessons to be learned from those years. And I think we perhaps at that moment assumed that the Chinese would never engage in military confrontation with India. Whatever we did, there was always would be an outlet for discussion, for coming to some terms. But I think we took the stand that we will remain where we stand, and we will remain there. I don't think it was ever at that moment perceived that you were dealing with a neighbor who became an adversary, who had a very had their own distinct case on the boundary vis-a-vis India. So in any negotiation, whether it's business or whether it's government or whether it's, even if you're buying a piece of property, there has to be some give and take. There has to be some adjustment. There has to be some degree of accommodation. I think that was not completely understood in that phase of our history. And I think unless China and India sit down and come to some terms that take into account the present realities as they exist, I don't think we can completely, change those realities. Whether, some adjustments can be made, mutual adjustments, so that we settle the boundary, that's the question. I don't think we've arrived at that point as yet. I'm not saying that it can never be achieved, but I think it will take time. And that's why I think in the interregnum, there is so much else that we can do in terms of environmental preservation, in terms of building more trade and connectivity, and more infrastructure for the people of the borderlands. That's where I think we should hasten. We should not prevaricate.
Thank you, Madam Rao, for a very interesting talk. I just wanted to focus on one of your slides. What can India learn from China, and ask two, three questions over that. So the first question is, the logical next question, what can China learn from India? because you didn't have a separate slide on that. The other thing is your emphasis seemed to be on the economic model that China adopted, you know, which produced all this growth.
That is just one slide, of course.
Sure. But I do want to focus on that. But it also produced extreme inequalities. You know, China is arguably more unequal than India. And China is more intensely contributing to climate change than India at this point. So the other logical question that immediately came to my mind is, what should India not learn from China?
Mm-hmm.
You know, in going further.
Have you been to China?
Several times.
So you know, I mean, you're probably a better judge of this than most of us. Well, I think that it's not that we need to, duplicate what the Chinese did. I think the only perhaps lesson to be learned from all this is that we have this behemoth of a neighbor next to us. And I think it would do us good when we wake up every morning to have a China consciousness. What are they doing? What have they achieved? What is it that they did well and what is it that they did not do so well? What are the lessons we can learn from that? I think that if we inculcate, internalize within ourselves, should be more than enough. I think we should avoid complacence and, you know, this constant, we shouldn't have this tendency to self-congratulation at the smallest sort of, appearance of a flower, as it were, in the desert. No, I don't think that is the way to go. I think we can learn a great deal from the Chinese about the power of perseverance, which I think in India we would do well. We have great reasoning powers. We are, I think, man to man or woman to woman, we can stand our own against the best in the world. But the fact is, as a group of people, as a community of people, as a population, what is it that we can learn from what the Chinese did? That capacity to eat bitterness, to withstand a lot of trouble and travail, and yet sort of with their, spine straight, not bent, I think that is something we could learn from them. I agree with you, the pollution, the environmental destruction in China, God forbid that it should happen in India, I hope it doesn't. But at the same time, let's not be complacent. The warning signs are there in India also. I think we have to wake up and make sure that we don't go down that path. But then a lot to learn from China in terms of the ground they've covered, their capacity to move mountains, literally. We would look at a mountain and say, no, that's sacred, we will not move it. But that's not the way the Chinese look at it.
What can China learn from India?
China can learn from, the Chinese, I think, in terms of our cultural and civilizational, legacy, I think, it's an outstanding legacy. I think the Chinese regard that as really special. And when it comes to one country, I think that they feel they can learn culturally from it's China. And they love our music, our culture, our entertainment. And in terms of our freedoms in India, despite, all said, the freedom that our people enjoy and the fact that democracy in India has been so resilient and has strengthened over the years. It has not weakened, It's not those dangerous decades that Selig Harrison and others spoke of. Completely not that. We have endured. That is something I think that the Chinese watch. I'm sure they ingest and internalize, though they don't speak so much about it. I think there's an East Asian approach to, when they see chaos or they see, dirt and dust and poverty, there is a certain reaction that many, the Japanese used to have it 20 years ago, but today they come to India. I think they've overcome that to a large extent. I think the Chinese should also do that. You really need more tourists coming to China. Very few Chinese tourists come to China. I hope this movie Xuanzang will help. And that will bring more Chinese. But you need more, very few Chinese students in India. We have about 12,000 Indian students studying in China today. But not even half that number in India. So the Indian government has to, or the Indian agencies have to really double up and do more to ensure that.
My name is Vijay Dandapani, I'm just the first person here. I am a shareholder. Indochina, watch it, if you will. What I got from this was, it's not a 0-1 relationship, so I really, it's a sense of color that you provided that I didn't think was there. My question is, what you alluded to, they've not ever sort of threatened India militarily in the two wars that India had against Pakistan, 65 and 71. Pakistan, as we were told, sought Chinese help, but it was not forthcoming. Where is the level of militarization on the other side of the border now? The level of mistrust that is still there in India, is there a similar level of mistrust in China on the other side, and does that comport with the level of militarization that you have on the other side of the border?
I think the other side is also heavily, it's very militarized, and I think their presence in the Tibet Autonomous Region and areas adjacent to India has really been consolidated through the development of better communication and infrastructure. The Chinese network of roads and accessibility to any part of our frontier is well established. So I think that in itself should be a cause for us to be on guard. And since it's an unsettled frontier, so we have to make sure that our own I wouldn't, I can't put it in such terms. Level of mistrust, I don't have a barometer to measure that. But I think there is, we call ourselves strategic partners. It's called strategic partnership, strategic cooperative partnership for peace and prosperity. Now, you have strategic partnerships all over the place. When you look at a diplomatic map, these, are galore. I think that the issue of Tibet, because the presence of the Dalai Lama in India and Tibetan refugees in India rankles with the Chinese, I think there's no doubt about that. Despite the fact that India has assured the Chinese from time to time that, we don't have any extraterritorial interests in Tibet. And the Dalai Lama is in India as a religious leader. We don't allow him to undertake political activities. We don't favor that either. So but despite that, I think at the popular level in China also, if they think of India, they think of the Dalai Lama being there. So, and so from the, and the PLA, the People's Liberation Army, and the Indian Defense Forces fought a war at one point. So I think it registers in the DNA of any army that you have fought that war and that, you have an adversary on the other side. I once spoke to an Indian Army officer and I said, "Do you regard China as an enemy?" He said, "Yes, I regard China as an enemy." So that the militaries think differently, I think. I mean, they have to be on guard. It's always against an enemy that you prepare, isn't it? You defend yourself, you train for that, you militarize because of that, because you apprehend a threat to your security. But I can't really, give you a kind of level of mistrust. But let me put it this way, that there are problems still that remain to be solved and settled. And we have to deal with that reality.
Ambassador, your question, please.
Thank you, Ambassador. I appreciate your speech, your address. We benefit a lot. You brought us the historic pictures. Or when China and the U.S. When China and India we were so close together. When those famous people like Tagore, and like Tang Yuanzhan and even Xuanzang a thousand years ago, we have the wonderful cultural exchanges. So we know from history, over 2,000 years ago, over 1,000 years ago, Chinese people like Xuanzang, they went to India to learn. To learn a religion, to learn a culture, and stayed 14 years in India. And also, he did a lot, like many others, for the bilateral relations, for the people to people contact. And until today, the Chinese people, because you were ambassador to China, you have been to China many times, you know the warm-hearted of the Chinese people toward the Indian people, the two giant neighboring countries. We learn each other from the culture, from the history, from the religion, and still today. You mentioned India welcomes more Chinese tourists. Because I worked and stayed in India for 3 years. Good time in India for in Chinese embassy. So still today, I take my time to
to notice, to pay attention to what is happening in India, what is happening between China and India, bilateral relationship. You mentioned the strategic partnership. So today, we know that more and more Chinese young guys, including young guys, they are interested to travel to India, to learn, to go to the first class, world-class universities in India. We're happy to know that. And like Indian young guys interested in China, in Chinese culture, in staying and studying in China. That is, you know, that is good for both of us, for both of our two giant Asian countries. I also want to mention that in recent years, you know how much importance was attached by the Chinese leadership to India, to the China-India relationship. In the year 2013, Premier Li Keqiang paid his state visit to India. And followed by the year 1914, President Xi Jinping had an important, also sort of historic visit to India. I was lucky, I was among the team to receiving the delegation to witness the historical moment. And also followed by the next year, 1915, the chairman of National People's Congress, our speaker. So you know the top three leaders of China visited India. You know how from the leadership to the people we cherish the friendship, the cooperation between China and India. That is good momentum for the two countries. And I still remember the detail in the year 1914, before when we were preparing for the visit, just visited by President Xi Jinping. We suggested Xi Jinping should make an important speech about the China-Indian relations, about the future of China and the South Asian countries. We suggest the speech should be made in India and in the Delhi University, or maybe Nehru University. But it was kind of unfortunate we couldn't do that. You know the details, but it's kind of unfortunate for me. But we know the importance and the friendly feelings we cherish towards each other. So when we were in India, when we were working for the bilateral relations, for promotion of the bilateral relations, we're talking about the trade deficit, about the Tibet issue, about the border issue, and others, among others. Maybe the most difficult part, the hard part, is the border issue you mentioned. So we know you mentioned in your speech, in your address, it will take time. It is not easy for the border dispute or border issue to be resolved satisfactorily to both sides, both to China and to India. It takes too much time and attention and energy to go through all the details in the historical papers, the maps you mentioned about the treaties, you know, inherited by Indian government from the British, from British government. We have also the proofs, evidence, a lot of things. So when I was working and living in India, I talked to Indian friends, officials, and the journalists. We say, maybe the most difficult issue, we know that, is the border issue. If we settle, resolve the border issue satisfactorily to both sides, that will be beneficial to both sides, for the two countries to evolve in deeper and more meaningful and huge, tremendous cooperation. So as a senior diplomat, as an expert knowing the China-Indian relations very well, maybe you have some ideas of your own to say how to we should try some techniques, maybe we have some steps to try to resolve the border issue, which is maybe over half a century already. Maybe now is the time to start, because when Premier Modi,
we'll call it off the record, you know, right?
Yeah. When Premier Modi is in power, some people say we missed a chance. When the in 1980s, we might have a chance. We have the environment to settle the issue. Maybe now is the time again, because Premier Modi, he's courageous. Because his wisdom, because of his courage, and the courage for the both the leaders of both countries, we might have some opportunity, the window of opportunity to settle the issue. Maybe you have some ideas and suggestions when we should start. That is my question. That is a question always in our mind and in the minds of many people, because we are working towards that goal. But we know it's difficult. But we should start to, you know, towards the settlement of it. Mm-hmm. So I'm eager to hear some of your ideas or your hint. What do you think about it?
How about we make a deal? Well, Rao will say something, and then also you have been studying in the water. Why don't you give a bit of a hint from that side and we'll try to do something?
Another issue, another problem in my mind is not a big one. When we're talking about the employment in India, because when I was in India, they say people met from Western countries. They always, before they came to work in India, they read a book by the author of the Financial Times. I forgot the name.
Edward Luce?
I forgot the name. I think it was in 2005.
Despite the Bronx, I
think. Yeah, he wrote a book about India. Because he married an Indian Chinese lady.
Yeah.
So he knows a lot about India. That helps him. So he talked about the employment. So they say the employment, the figure is like 30 million to 40 million, which I could not understand. So how to understand the figure, the real employment in India today? That is also a question in my mind. So when you are here, it's a chance for me to get the response.
Well, I have studied the figures of unemployment. Now, all I referred to it in my speech also, that India is a very young country. About more than 50% of the population of India is below the age of 25. So I think the focus of the government has to be on how you develop skills and vocational training for all these young kids. 98% of children in India today are in school, because now we have the Right to Education Act that has made it compulsory for all children to be in school. So you're going to have a lot of people coming out of school, even if they've done 8 or 9 grades, they may not even have finished high school, but they'll be literate. They wouldn't know how to read and write, and they will have aspirations and expectations, and how are you going to channel them that into productive activity? I think that's the real challenge. So I'm talking of 400 million jobs that you have to create, so many every month. I don't know what the figure is, but a few million, or 1 million jobs every month. So I think we have to focus on that, and that is what Mr. Modi is trying to focus on. I think we can't afford to have any delay on that, because aspirations are involved, aspirations of the young. We talk of our demographic dividend, the dividend, because we have so many young people, we can harness those energies, they'll be very productive for the growth of the country, increase the rate of GDP growth. But you have to make sure that these people are trained and have jobs. So manufacturing has to go up. He wants to bring manufacturing to about 25% of the GDP. Today it's about 17%. So you have to, raise that level. So this is the work that needs to be done. As far as the border dispute is concerned, I think there's a process involved. Everything should have a process, accompanied by discipline. And when I mean discipline, I think we have a very free and democratic society. And all people have, many people have different opinions on this. So I think the government and the people who know the issue well, who know the history of the issue well, have to educate public opinion also about the nature of the dispute and, you know, what happened in the past that could have been dealt with differently. What are the lessons that we, as I mentioned, that we can learn? We have to educate public opinion, and that applies to China also. We have to prepare the country for both our countries for what a solution will be. And I don't know if your leadership has thought of what that solution will be, and I don't believe in our own establishment there is, you know, a ready-made sort of formula as to how this can be resolved. But when I look back at Premier Chowinlai's visit to India in April 1960, 56 years ago, he came with his six-point proposal, as you know. He made a six-point proposal about how to settle the boundary question. Maybe that should become a kind of a point of departure. But I don't know if the Chinese establishment is prepared, because so much water has flown down the Ganges and the Yangtze since then. So much water. And positions have changed. On the Chinese side, to be very frank, I think positions have hardened. Because now, you know, this whole issue of the eastern sector has become, Arunachal Pradesh has become a kind of a sticking point, a bone of strong contention. That was not the case in 1960, not to that extent. Though, you know, you had issues about the McMahon line and the so-called illegality of it. But Premier Chowinlai came to Delhi with some proposals, and he talked about it. I mean, it was public knowledge. And I'll leave it at that.
Well, I think on that happy note, you know, both India can afford to be large-hearted from our perspective. Right? That's what we have learned. That's what we have learned over the past 10 years. That I think, you know, all these issues, you know, you can have, you know, amazing conversations that in many ways they just can, you know, keep you just engaged. But when you talk about border issues, this is one topic that I think can really, you know, it's an endless conversation, but an important one. And I think, you know, we'll try to.
That's when the quotation from Mario Manz was very, I think, appropriate.
That's right, that's right. Mm-hmm. One group of our fellows, India China Institute scholars, that brings scholars from India, from China, and the US, they're actually about to publish an edited volume. It's called Crossing Borders. And the idea is to really reimagine, one is a government, you know, a nation state narrative, but there are other narratives which I think in some ways Ambassador Rao also referred to. I think those also needs to be also explored simultaneously. So at our level as academics, I think we're engaged in that conversation as well. So, but anyway, I think we are over our time here, and I just want to, you know, you all to join me in thanking Ambassador Rao.